I talk about cooperation with the Human Cell Atlas project. And this is an unusual area of science. Most areas of science, if you want to hear about them, you go to the standard meetings and they decide what things get on the program. And so the most important stuff gets a lot of play on the program. You can tell just from looking at the meeting program what areas you should be learning about. The big meetings that I go to have been entirely silent about the Human Cell Atlas project, even though it's probably going to be as large or larger than the Human Genome Project and of similar importance. Well, how did I find out about it? I found out about it on Facebook. And on Facebook, LinkedIn, you know, social media, it's just all over the place. You can't be on Facebook and not have heard of the Human Cell Atlas. But if you're one of these physicians or scientists who are frightened to death of Facebook, you're going to be completely, blindsided by this. There'll be big things happening with the Human Cell Atlas, this single cell genomics, using microfluidics to kind of analyze genomics of cells one by one. That if you just take the old traditional ways of keeping up with science, you'll know nothing about it. If you're big on social media, you'll know everything about it. So it makes it hard for me to tell you how important it really is. I would say I can't really judge that. But it is related to tissue engineering pathology, because people say to me, well, can't you kind of summarize, like, one sentence or phrase what tissue engineering pathology is? And it is getting the right cells in the right places in a bioengineered organ. Well, that sounds simple if you think you know what cells are supposed to be there. But as you'll find out in this lecture, we thought that we knew that. Like, for the past 18 or 20 years, we thought we knew in every organ in the human body how many cell types there were and exactly what they were and so on. And now that you can analyze the genome of individual cells one by one, it turns out there are a lot more cell types than we ever thought. So that's the way that the two are related. Regenerative medicine, tissue engineering, cell therapy, there are three terms used for similar things. Regenerative medicine over the past 20 years or so, the use of the term has remained more or less constant. Cell therapy has been going up. Tissue engineering has been going down. But they don't quite mean exactly the same thing, but they're used in sort of overlapping ways. And they have to do not only with, like, generating organs from scratch from stem cells, like recreating embryological development, but also taking a previous organ, flushing out all the cells, so you have sort of the framework that the cells were in, and then reinfusing new cells, reinfusing stem cells into that template, and then growing a new organ that way. It also has to do with repair of existing organs. So take an organ that has damage, infuse stem cells in it, into it, that will repair the organ. So all those things are regenerative medicine, tissue engineering, cell therapy. Now, why is that interesting? So I'm in the transplantation field, and transplantation has been a wonderful advance, and we're very proud of the things that we're doing. But if you take a really big picture look, we only serve 10% of the patients who need an organ. So most patients die waiting. That is the reality. It's a reality you don't hear about very much. You hear about the successes going on in the 10% of patients who receive organs, but a lot of patients do not receive the organs that they need. So with regenerative medicine transplantation, using stem cell generated organs, stem cell repaired organs, bioengineered organs, you could provide organs for everyone, assuming that the cost comes down to something reasonable. And how many lives would that save a year? About 1.2 million people need an organ to sustain life each year. So we only serve 10% of this number. So over 1 million people would be saved each year if we were able to provide organs to everybody that need them. How close are we? Well, it depends on the kind of organ. Structurally simple organs, we're pretty close. We've been able to do stem cell generated bladders for some time, trachea, esophagus, vagina. But other more complex organs, it clearly will take some time before we're able to recreate the whole organ. But even those, at the present time, we can create organoids, which are little like pieces of the organ that have all the parts, but they don't completely function because they don't have the major, you know, connections. So like a liver organoid would be doing the things that normal liver cells do, but doesn't have connection to, you know, the bile ducts and all that kind of thing. But it still can be useful. The organoid constructs can be useful in testing toxicities. What compounds are toxic to various organs? So you don't have to use living animals for that then. So this is that paper of mine from this month. And the other thing that might excite you about this is there are a lot of people your age on the author line. I'm quite proud of that. But the second, third, fourth, and fifth author are all in their 20s or early 30s. So anyway, that happens. So that's kind of the deal. And clearly the Human Cell Atlas is an important part of what I'm talking about here. It's mentioned in the abstract in collaboration with the Human Cell Atlas Project. There are only two abbreviations in the article, and one is an abbreviation for the Human Cell Atlas Project. So obviously that is an important part of this. So why is it important? Well, as I said, there's something missing in the concept of tissue engineering pathology, and that is knowing what kind of cells should be there, how many cell types are necessary to sustain life. And it may seem simple, but it's really not. So for a long time, it's been thought that in the kidney, there are 26 cell types. But you notice that this is quite an old article. It's from 2002. That's 16 years ago. But the other thing that you'd find kind of charming about it, it's an exceptionally well-written article. No matter what vantage point you are coming from, you'd find the writing of this fascinating. You would learn a great deal from it. So I think that's one of the reasons that it's still widely referred to. But sometimes a very good article kind of stops science because people think this is it. You know, just like in the previous century, physics reached a point where people thought, well, we've learned everything that there is to know. An article like this, I think, gave people the impression there really are 26 cell types in the kidney, and that's it. And so we have that knowledge, and, you know, we'll just move on from here. It's interesting. You may think this number of 26 is sort of arbitrary. It is the number of different letters in the alphabet. There are other things that there are 26 of. If you look at white cell types, if you go to any standard reference, just count up the number of white cell types. That also turns out to be 26. So how are we going to figure out? So now we're able to do single cell RNA transcripts to determine the genome of individual cells, telling you not only what the cell is, but its state, its lineage, you know, lots of other things, not only about what type of cell it is, but what state of activation it is. If it's a cell that commonly divides, you know, how close it is to that point, and so on. So you can tell a lot of things. So one interesting study, they applied the human cell atlas analysis to a subset of white cells, dendritic cells and monocytes. And in the original understanding of the white cell population in human beings, it was believed that there were six cell types. And after they completed the human cell atlas analysis and reclassified, there were 12. So I think this is the most conservative evidence for what the magnitude of the impact of the human cell atlas could be. And that is that in every organ in the body, the number of cell types we thought were there is actually now doubled. There is at least twice as many cell types as we thought before. And if you think of the impact of that, whatever your favorite organ is, the impact of that is probably huge. That because of this feeling that, you know, whatever organ you've been interested in, it's kind of like physics, and you know, a century ago where people thought all knowledge was known and so on. So we thought we knew what all the cell types were, and you know, everything was being analyzed on the basis of those cells. So we presume that, for instance, in the kidney, if you double it, the number of types, that would be going to 52. And so maybe there are 52 major cell types in the kidney, 52 major cell types in white blood cells, and so on. I don't know whether young people today know about this book still, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. The last group of young people I talked to, 25% of them knew about this book. But anyway, this book contains the claim that the meaning of life, the universe, and everything is 42. So I'm saying that maybe it's actually 52 if you use the human cell atlas. There are probably thousands of subtypes, so the number of cells, the number of types, is large but finite and also definable. And one assumes that in the next few years, as the Human Cell Atlas project plays out, we will be able to define all of this. If you just think about the kidney, just because I spent a lot of time thinking about the kidney, if you wouldn't mind thinking about it for just a short time, kidney medicine today A lot of it is based on examination of the urine, urinalysis, which you may know has a 6,000-year history. Just think about that for a moment. It's like the earliest area of laboratory medicine. You may know that language is only 5,000 years old. So this antedates by 1,000 years language. So people were drawing, you know, urine containers and, you know, analysis of the urine for 1,000 years before we had written language. That's one side of it. One presumes that you could get much more information about patients by analyzing the cells coming out in the urine this way, doing cell, you know, genomics one cell at a time. It would be non-invasive, as you well know. It could be done like every hour, every 2 hours, you could. And, you know, so if, and most people would think that it would be flawed because the cells in the urine are mostly dead, but that's not true. The cells in the urine are mostly alive. They can be grown in culture. They're not that different from the cells that are healthy in, you know, the kidney. You are constantly shedding cells into the urine, and it's just that the way that we analyze the urine today is so non-specific and vague that it's just not an important means of coming to any final answer usually. And if you think about the kidney biopsy, which is my area of work, my day job, and I'm not teaching this course, is that we've been using the same three modalities of examining the biopsy for a very long time. Probably the most recent change was to begin looking for a molecule called C4D, and that occurred in the late 90s, so at least, you know, 20 years ago. And then we started doing immunofluorescence about 60 years ago, you know, electron microscopy 70 years ago. So the three modalities used to examine the kidney biopsy are very old. And one could imagine that what you would do with a portion of the biopsy is basically disaggregate the cells. So you had a solution of single cells, put them through this microfluidic device, and get this single cell analysis of a large number of cells. And I think it probably could quickly tell you much more than any of the other ways that we're currently looking at kidney biopsies. So it could revolutionize and make much more precise the diagnosis of kidney disease. What about other organs? I think it's absolutely the same for every other organ. Any area of medicine or, you know, science of the human body that might interest you, I think this would have a huge impact and make all the data much more precise. It is very quick. You're limited by the speed of, you know, computation. So the cells are just whizzing past. You're getting these single cell analyses of individual cells, but I think there's no reason to think that it won't continue to speed up. So let me just So we frequently in this course talk about Moore's Law, price performance of computing. You're aware of the concept of exponential change. But actually, the changes going on with the human cell atlas are much more rapid than this. So this curve, which predicts that machines will be smarter than individual humans in 2029, and smarter than the whole aggregate human race in 2045, this degree of change is a doubling every 2 years. So now, if we compare that, it's this recent paper, Moore's Law in Single-Cell Transcriptomics, in other words, in the Human Cell Atlas project. So this scale, 1, 10, 100,000, 10,000, 100,000 million, you can see that in 2009, you could only do one cell at a time, and it was very laborious and so on. So you were limited to one. So by 2010 sometime, you could do dozens of cells, and by 2011, 2012, you got to 100. And now we're up to nearly a million. Probably by 2019, we'll be able to do a million cells at a time. So I'm sure, because you're taking this course, and you know the course has a lot about Moore's Law and stuff, that you're very impressed by Moore's Law. But if you compare the two, this line here would be the Moore's Law change, in other words, doubling every 2 years. And this is what is actually happening with single-cell transcriptomics. So it is accelerating much more quickly than that. And it's kind of exciting to think of something that's like an exponential on top of another exponential. So, and I don't want you to think there's anything particularly renal or kidney-oriented about the impact. I think it will have a similar impact in every single organ. And, of course, it won't just be in people. I have a human medicine orientation, but it will impact all living things. It may surprise you to know that there's a lot of activity going on here at the U of A related to regenerative medicine. Not only the things that I have been doing, but for instance, the Viacite trial, this is an encapsulated pancreatic progenitor cell that is used to treat type 1 diabetes. We are one of the major clinical sites for that. The study's going quite well, and Dr. James Shapiro here in the Department of Surgery is one of the lead investigators. So regenerative medicine would be pretty easy maybe to conceptualize if everything about it was positive, but it's not. There is stem cell fraud, stem cell hype, intellectual dishonesty in stem cell medicine, probably greater than that in any other area of medicine. So it's kind of hard to put everything you know about stem cell research together and to come to just one, you know, opinion that you like it or you don't like it, or you're in favor of it, or you want to be a part of it, or you want to stay, you know, away. It's an interesting intellectual challenge. It's like in the book 1984, the idea of doublethink. Doublethink is holding two conflicting ideas in your mind at the same time and accepting them both, right? Sounds like it's not possible, but we really do things like that. I guess you'd say it's, you know, provisional acceptance, right? We're kind of balancing back and forth between these two conflicting ideas. And in regenerative medicine, it's like more than two ideas. You're trying to sort of decide, well, given the reality that exists, you know, what part should I play in this? What should I do? And so on. It is possible to figure that out, but we have found that it's a bit too complicated to get people to voluntarily come into a room. Like if you're going to speak to the general public, you need something else to interest them. And what we've been doing is incorporating this in poetry and music, because if you just give a lecture, people just won't stand for it. I mean, you're not giving a clear answer. What do you mean that this is the greatest hope for the future of medicine? It's the area where the greatest intellectual dishonesty is, and there's this stem cell tourism with people going to these poorly documented clinics in the third world, and there's, you know, the whole, you know, celebrity effect, and you're probably all, you know, guilty of this. You all have like a favorite celebrity or sports star, and if that person goes to some clinic somewhere and gets an injection and comes back and says it's the best thing since sliced bread, then you'll want it too, and so on. It's a very complicated world. So somehow, rather than just lecturing about this stuff, if you incorporate it in a sort of entertaining evening, you can get people to start thinking about it in a way that they might otherwise not really stand or sit still for. So Timothy Caulfield in our Health Law Institute here at the U of A is like the world's expert on the stem cell hype, the you know, celebrity effects. This is a huge issue. Like if you think about autism and the belief that vaccines are somehow related to that, that has no basis in science, but it has a basis in, you know, good-looking celebrities telling you this, right? And that's like a force that you would think would have no influence on you whatsoever, but it seems to influence people much more than one might like. So this is just some of what the health law unit here, some of their recent publications. Combating unlicensed stem cell interventions, from Kim Kardashian to Dr. Oz, future relevance, popular culture, so on, so forth. And Timothy really is like the world's expert in this. And so that is also here at the U of A. And there is another way to think about this. That is that within medicine, the areas that attract young people vary over time. In the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, there was nothing more appealing than kidney medicine and, you know, transplantation, transplant surgery. It was just amazingly exciting, and the best and the brightest young people wanted to get into those fields. And now it's considerably different. There is worldwide difficulty interesting young people in kidney medicine, transplantation. Most people choose some other field. And I think that regenerative medicine will probably change that, because once the basic thought is that we can provide this benefit to everyone, it becomes a much more satisfying field to be in than the idea that, you know, we're constantly making these ethical choices between people and not worrying about the fact that in some countries you can't get this kind of therapy at all, and so on. If you were doing something that provided uniform benefit throughout the world to everybody who needed it, it would be a much more satisfying area to be in. I think the other way to think about this is your personal involvement. You may be sitting here thinking, what, me? I'm not involved at all. I have nothing to do with this. But likely you have a skill or an interest that could be applied here, and making regenerative medicine successful is in every human being's interest. And if we all assume that we're waiting for somebody else to do it and then, you know, tell me when it's done and then I'll come back, then it's going to take decades to really make this successful and, you know, worldwide in impact. So it is likely that there is something you could do, and it's challenging enough. This is kind of a joke or an attempt at humor, but a lot of people are worried about technological unemployment. The things I've talked about up until now are complex enough that you can imagine that machines might have a little bit of difficulty figuring this all out. So there probably is still going to be a role for human beings, human, you know, physicians and so on here. Maybe kidney medicine docs and renal pathologists will be the only people still employed in 2045. So this is the Banff classification of allograft or transplant pathology that I developed 27 years ago. This is the logo for it. And maybe the first thing you might be interested in, kind of boring listening to somebody who's been in this for such a long time. So what do the young doctors think of this? And so we have this histologic scoring where we take this the various changes you see under the microscope in the kidney and score them on 0 to 3+. And our youngest kidney pathologist, who's just joined the faculty, says use of the Banff classification gives you the imprimatur of being an educated transplant pathologist. It's proof that you know what you're doing. So anyway, that's what he says about it. Do you know that word, imprimatur? It comes from a printing term, let it be printed. So it's the origin of that. So these are like the highlights in the Banff classification. It was without any structure whatsoever until 2013, when my colleague Lorraine Rackeson and I, we sort of managed it almost like a family or something, without any society or any rules or stuff between 91 and 2013. In 2013, we established a nonprofit Swiss foundation. So I'm currently the chair of that foundation, and I stepped down in 2019 and will be replaced by Michael Mengel at that time. Surprisingly, for something that is 27 years old, the number of publications about it continues to go up. You may know that this institution is sixth in the world in terms of its ranking for the scientific area of transplantation. And it's largely on the basis of the literature citations of the Banff classification. And you can imagine when we add tissue engineering pathology to that, that the number of citations will even go up. You're probably wondering now what whether I'm going to test you on these slides. No, I'm not going to test you on these slides. I just think you know, this is me. This is what I've been doing. I thought you'd be interested in it, but you're not going to be tested on this slide. But it is a, you know, consensus process that is moderated by experts. That's pretty unusual. If you look in the books, how to generate consensus, every book tells you, you get a professional facilitator who has no stake in the game, knows nothing about the area. Bring him in, he'll tell everybody this new way to think, and they'll put post-its on the board, and magically consensus will come about. That's never the way that we've done it. But if experts are moderating consensus. You have to be somewhat humble. If somebody else in the room has a better idea than you, and if the will of the people in the room is to go with that person's idea, you have to accept that people are going to do that rather than coming in with a macho idea that your way or the highway or, you know, that you are much smarter than anyone else and should always dominate the process. I would absolutely kill it. So this is kind of a diagram of the way it's been working. These are the people in the various roles. So we have organ-specific committees, program committees for each meeting every 2 years. And traditionally, young people have played a very important role in these meetings because in 2007, I lost major funding for the professional staff that I had. So the templates for what the people were doing was very well established. So I just got rid of these highly paid professionals, got students to do the same thing, paid them hardly anything, but they were doing this awesome stuff no one else in the world was doing. And it's been working very well since 2007. So the success of this is owing to the efforts of many young people like yourselves. These are pictures from the Banff meetings, and this is the latest one that was in Barcelona, Spain. So the idea that regenerative medicine is reality now is something that there is some resistance to, but this is the best journal in the field, American Journal of Transplantation. And when this appeared on the cover in November 2014, people who had been resisting thinking about regenerative medicine realized that the jig was up, and they needed to start thinking about this, because this must be a reality if it's on the cover. And so I think to a certain extent that is true, and I'm one of the major forces that keeps, you know, reminding people about this. So I've been talking about this since my first after dinner speech in 2011. So that's like 7 years. And now it is more and more a tangible reality. So we have to think about addressing organ dysfunction and organ failure in this way of thinking of cells like stem cells or organ progenitor cells, scaffolds for them to grow in, bioactive factors so they do the right stuff and grow the right way, and then a bioengineered organ brought about by these tissue engineered constructs. And I keep asking about this slide, whether we still need it, the idea of jump starting, the idea that in every audience there would be resistance, people who really don't think this has anything to do with them, and it's not never going to be a reality, and so on. And I'm assured that we do still need this slide. So as soon as we don't need the jump start slide, I will get rid of it. So we have to start thinking about how to keep the cells in a bioengineered organ happy. And there are some very challenging things that I'm sure we'll get over these hurdles. But for instance, it's hard in a reconstructed organ where you take all the cells out and then infuse new cells in. It's hard to get pavementing of more than about 80 to 90% of the endothelial surface of the arteries and the veins. And the surfaces that don't have endothelium clot like mad. So everything else is working fine, and you've got all the cells maybe in the right places inside the organ, but you hook it up and the main vessels supplying the organ clot. So that's something we will get over, but it's obviously one challenge at the moment. So you may wonder, is this an area that Canadian citizens are interested in and supportive of? Supposedly it is. From a public policy perspective, Canadians are in support of radical life extension and of doing that through regenerative medicine. So early in the course, we talked a lot about the technological singularity in general, this idea that in 2045 or earlier or later that machines will be much smarter than we are, take over the future agenda of the world, and we can only have influence and understand what happens if we join or merge with them in some way. So there is an equally interesting kind of medical singularity you can think of when this becomes routine, where when we need a new organ, we just take somebody's old organ, flush out the cells, grow up some of your cells, infuse your cells into that organ, allow the cells to proliferate, find the right places and stuff, and then you have a new organ that is completely compatible with you, that you're not going to reject, and someday we will be able to do that. So what is tissue engineering pathology? Well, things don't go entirely well thus far. So this is an animal model of doing that. And in the rat, if you flush out the cells and then flush in new cells and so on, not only do you not get enough cells in the places where you want them, but you get odd phenomenon. Like ordinarily, this is the filtering unit of the kidney that's called the glomerulus, and it has specialized epithelial cells called podocytes that stain for podocin, and you don't ever get podocin positive cells anywhere else in the kidney, but in the bioengineered reconstituted kidney you do. So you get podocytes wandering around in the interstitium. It's just one of many abnormalities that you can find in the bioengineered organ. So there are many problems with stem cell generated organs that are not being discussed. And some of them are challenging, but a lot of them probably require a background of things that you already know and things that where you could provide part of the solution. I talked about the first line about the clotting of the non-endothelial surfaces. Hard to get right cell types of cells in the right places. You get terminally differentiated cells, it's hard to get more of them, hard to identify progenitors sometimes. And in the kidney, you know, your ability to concentrate the urine, the reason you can sit in a room like this, and although the amount of fluid going through your kidney is greater than what your bladder can hold, you're just fine because you're able to concentrate the urine. So you don't have to like run to the bathroom every 10 minutes, right? But if you only had short loops of Henle, if you didn't have any long loops, you would not be able to concentrate the urine. And when you regenerate kidneys, that's mostly what you get, that it's very hard to have those long loops of Henle created. The cells seem to prefer to take shortcuts. So you could end up with a kidney that can do everything else but cannot concentrate the urine. So there are two ways to think about that. Maybe you could think of a bioengineered organ like a device, right? So you go into a store and you see the specs for your new cell phone, and it's certain features that you want and apps you want it to have and stuff. Maybe a bioengineered organ is like that. And you could just accept that it's really hard to get a kidney that can concentrate the urine, but you would want one that can do everything else. So you would accept that and say, well, we're just going to deal with this in some other way. in terms of the concentration of the urine and the fact that it can do all these other things, that it can generate, you know, erythropoietin so that red cells are generated. It can, you know, get rid of waste. It can do everything except concentrate the urine. Maybe from a kind of, you know, device perspective, that's just fine. In the early days of bioengineered organs, you can't expect them to do absolutely everything that the native organ does. But many old-fashioned questions from physiology, things that you've already learned in school, and maybe you thought this was like old news and you'd never use that knowledge, you took a test on it and you've moved on, you never need that. Those same questions are now interesting enough, are interesting again in trying to figure out how to make bioengineered organs. So old-fashioned concepts like the intact nephron hypothesis, cell regeneration, the stunned myocardium, contraction band, necrosis, those are all terms for things that you might have learned about that you think you'll never need the information again. But it really is useful when you're trying to figure out how to make a regenerative medicine organ work. So we really are at the very beginning, and it's kind of exciting to think we're at the beginning. That's what Richard Feynman said back in the day, and it's probably still true. We are at the very beginning of time for the human race. It's not unreasonable that we grapple with problems. There are tens of thousands of years in the future. I'm not sure you all believe that, but I'm just saying Feynman was probably smarter than you are, so he might have known bit more about life than you do. Our responsibility is to do what we can, learn what we can, improve the solutions, and pass them on. Yeah, anyway, a lot of other people have had this same idea that as long as humans have lived on Earth, we're still at the very beginning of what could be a very long period for us here. And so we should kind of think about things that way, rather than thinking we're near the end. I don't know if you know about the Crystal Palace in London. It was for a long time the largest like glass-lined building, and then it burned down and so on. I think it's being recreated in 2018. But in 1851, there was the first international classification of diseases presented at this grand exhibition of technology at London's Crystal Palace. And that international classification of diseases was tremendously death-oriented. Cause of death, time of death. And I think what I would like to think about is that our focus with tissue engineering pathology is on life, right? So, are the abnormalities seen compatible with an organ that would provide net benefit to the patient? Will this organ sustain life? So these are just some of the questions we might ask about a regenerative medicine construct, bioengineered organ. This is a rat model of a bioengineered kidney, and this is a kidney tubule. Looks very different from a normal tubule. It's got these multiple interconnecting paths. And down here is a glomerulus with hardly any cells in it, disordered tubule formation. And cynics have said, can you call this a kidney? Well, of course you can. It has all the usual things. It's got tubules, glomeruli. They're just a bit funny looking, right? So rather than insulting the organ and saying, that's not a kidney, I think we should try to figure out how to make such organs better and to figure out what the threshold is for when they would provide net benefit to the patient. These pencil sketches were done by Corey Fung, who is a student approximately your age, and we did them with the idea that the journal would have a professional artist recreate them in color, but they decided to rush the article into print. So those are the pictures that you'll see. His original pencil sketches are the art that's in the article. So this shows this idea of the short loops of Henle that could not concentrate the urine, the long loops of Henle. Okay, and what about the chance of neoplastic transformation? That means the creation of malignant tumors. The classification should have reproducible categories, generalizable concepts, not just one-off kind of accidental things that happened. And tissue engineering pathology has been an unnamed kind of area for a long time. There's been literature about the reaction to scaffolds for growing cells and so on, but it's been pretty dull, kind of like in the movies where the cop says, "Move along, nothing to see here," you know. But now it's getting more interesting with lives hanging in the balance kind of thing. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of the lecture. And in addition to answering questions about the lecture, I would be happy to answer questions about the midterm also if you wish. So, any questions? Okay, the midterm is on the 27th. It's a combination of short answer and multiple choice. It is somewhat similar to the quiz that you got on the first day, and some of the questions are the same as in that quiz. And it's a little bit longer than in previous years because the students actually complained that the test was too short, that they knew more than the test was actually measuring. They felt cheated. Okay, I'll fix that. Yeah, so the test used to take about 40 minutes, and then we all stood around looking at each other for the rest of the time, or there's one student taking 80 minutes, and the other student's wondering, what's wrong with that guy kind of thing. So now the exam will probably take you about 60 minutes, something like that. It's a kind of, you know, benign process. I think most people are shocked at how low their raw score is, and then pleasantly surprised with how high their, you know, corrected score is once we do the scaling. And I've not received any like threats of people saying, I understand you've been scaling the grades in that course. We want to talk to you. No, it seems to be like a, you know, benign thing that people are not upset about. So any questions? Does single cell genomics, is this something you'd heard about in any other class or late night party or on Facebook, or is this your first ever exposure to the idea of human cell atlas? Yes, wow. Okay, well, I'm glad I told you. Now you know, so. Yeah, if you search for that on Facebook, you'll find zillions of links. And if you search for it in meeting programs, you won't find any. So it is kind of an interesting puzzle at the moment. So. I was very pleased at how, you know, engaged you were on Tuesday. I think somehow Patrick seemed to hit exactly the right nerve. But I would point out that none of the other lecturers are capable of that, I think, although maybe, you know, Gary is. So Patrick sat on the on the back of a chair most of the time, leaning backwards. So you could imagine that most of his weight was balanced on that side of the chair, but he didn't fall over once. And he just kept doing that. I'm sure that's not the only reason that the students remained, you know, engaged, but he was putting himself physically at risk kind of the whole time. And he's very paranoid about these screens. I guess he's been seriously frustrated by them. So he just came in and decided to do the old-fashioned writing on the board kind of thing. And then he sent them out on a forced march to measure things in the hallway and so on, and then they had to come back and report. And for this group of students, that just seemed to be absolutely right. I don't know, somehow. They all looked happy and like, finally, this course was doing what they wanted. So what was it like for you? Why did it work so well? Do you have other classes like that? I mean, do you have other profs who sit on the back of their chair and look like they're going to fall over backwards but don't? Is that a common thing that profs do these days? Or
nobody? I don't think so.
Oh, okay. I didn't think it was either. And I don't think my insurance would actually cover me if I did that. Yes.
I mean, it indicates a high level of trust in the chair.
Yes.
And in the engineer who built it.
Yes, yes.
But I just wanted to add something. You know, I think you know, for the ethics lectures in the course, which are next month,
right?
A lot of the material you gave today is fodder for consideration. In the ethical angles of the future of medicine, this is a good illustration of what we're dealing with. We're trying to make ethical decisions about how to wield this technology, but it's always changing and continues to change. So I think one of the fundamental questions is, how do we develop a sense of setting up a system that will guide us in the right direction in something that's always changing? You know,
yeah.
If we thought there were 6 cells, but then we know that there are 12, and we can reasonably suspect there might yet be a whole bunch to be discovered.
Yes.
It makes us question, how much do we know right now?
Yeah, and the other way to think about this, I would urge you all sometime in the next 20 years, watch Leslie Cormack's lecture in this course. She's the Dean of Arts, and she only spoke here once, but it's really moving. She only has 16 slides. I thought, boy, it's going to be a completely inadequate lecture. Who would ever come to a class with 16 slides? But what she basically does is tells you what medicine was like in the Middle Ages and convinces you it was as complete as medicine is today. There were answers to every question. There were therapies for everything you might present with. You might think that it's completely bogus and there's no basis for any of the therapeutic decisions made, but there is an outside chance, just as you know, Gary Goldsand's saying now, that maybe some of our therapies today are similarly, we think we know why we're doing it, but maybe it's entirely wrong, you know? And I think most people had the idea that living in the Middle Ages, you kept thinking, if only my doctor knew more, you know, if only these things had been discovered. But nobody was thinking that. It's all thinking about, well, I wonder if I have the right humors, you know, I wonder if my friend died because, you know, black magic, white magic, trying to figure out what kind of magic it was, you know. And so there were theories, there were ways of explaining practically anything that could happen to you, and a variety of different ways of treating. And as bad as it may seem, like the outcomes weren't all that good, the fact is that people kind of believed in that stuff, just like we believe in the medicine of today. So it is sobering to realize that our medicine today, which we're very proud of, it's no more complete in a sense than the medicine of the Middle Ages, which also was a complete system. Yeah. Any other questions?